You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Jerry Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And this is the program where we talk about everything about gardens, from trees to turf, from apples to zinnias, anything that you grow in your garden, or things that you grow in your garden that you don't want to grow in your garden. And we'll be talking today a little bit about weeds, about water, and about insects. Now, we always start our show with some upcoming events, and I just want to remind our audience that we are live, and you can call in with questions about your garden, or you can email us. There was the email address there on the screen. In addition, you can call in with questions about your garden. I'm a plant pathologist and a certified arborist and a California Agricultural Pest Control Advisor, so I ought to be able to answer your questions. If not, I can look it up or direct you where you can get your answer. And we've had a lot of rain over the last few days. We're going to talk about that a little bit. We're going to talk about how to water gardens, how to reduce your water use, because even though we got that rain, we're still in drought conditions. And you can pretty much just assume that we're always in a drought condition in California. We never have quite enough water to go around for everyone's needs. I brought in some weeds that I plucked out of my garden this morning. And we'll talk about these weeds in a moment, but let's see if we have some upcoming events that we can put on our screen so you can write down and go out and enjoy some of our great outdoor weather and learn something about gardens. Smart gardening workshops at Roosevelt Park, March 8th, from 8:30 to 11. And you can give them a call there at 1-888-CLEAN-LA, or check on their website at smartgardening.com. They'll cover all the types of things you should need to know about gardening, about integrated pest management, how to water, how to control weeds, which we're going to talk about a little bit today. So that's a good thing to attend. In addition to that, we have the perfect flowering trees at the Arboretum on March 5th from 1:30 to 3:00, and you'll be able to take a look at all the different flowering trees that do quite well in Southern California. Give them a call at 626-821-4623 to inquire about the cost, or, you know, and let them know you're coming so they know how many people to expect. In addition to that, we have organic fruit and vegetable gardening at the Arboretum on March 8th from 12 to 4. So you can learn more about how to grow your fruits and vegetables using organic techniques, avoiding using broad-spectrum insecticides or pesticides. And we'll talk about that as well next week when we talk about integrated pest management. In addition to that, let's see if we have anything else. No, that's it for our upcoming events. And let's move on and talk about weeds. They're going to start coming up now. We've had a very dry winter, which will obviously reduce weed growth extensively in open soil. Now, if you have a lawn and you're irrigating it, then you're going to continue to have weed problems in your lawn. But, you know, in a vacant lot, or if you've got a vegetable garden that was fallow during the winter, you probably didn't have a lot of weed growth because we had so little rain. Just remind you, you can call in with questions about your garden at 1-800-339-1193. Give us a call. I'd love to talk to you about your garden. Yeah. So anyway, we've had so little rain that basically very few weeds have really been growing, because weeds need water to grow, and if it doesn't rain, then you get very little weed growth. But now we got a good soaking. We're going to see some weeds starting to come up. I've got a few weeds in my backyard that grow around some of my fruit trees. I have very few weeds in my backyard because I practice kind of a mulching, heavy mulching, to suppress the weeds. It's very effective. I don't necessarily use herbicides very much. I do use them a little bit, particularly for certain species that are invasive and very difficult to control. Even if you pull them up, you don't get them all, and they come back and come back and come back. Particularly Bermuda grass and I've forgotten the other one that's really a pain in my backyard, morning glory. Morning glory is very invasive. Some of the other invasive vine-type weeds, like passion vine, they'll come in and grow on top of trees and shrubs if you don't pull them out all the time. So anyway, let's take a look at some of these weeds. Maybe before we look at the weeds themselves, I'll show you a couple books on weeds. I might have shown you these books before, but I'll show them to you again. This is Weeds of California and Other Western States in two volumes from the University of California. So here they are, and you can see that they're pretty thick books. They've got a lot of weeds in here. I don't think they actually have keys. These are most likely more like an encyclopedia. And I've marked on a couple pages the weeds that I've collected in my garden today. And what I collected in the garden today are really quite common. Here's one other book. This one's probably out of print. Now, this you can get from the University of California. It's still in print. Most gardeners really don't need a huge set of books like this to identify weeds. You can always pull up your weeds and send them to me at my laboratory with the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office, and I'll tell you what your weeds are. You can take pictures of your weeds. You can email them to me at my lab. And I can tell you what they are if you just send me pictures, for the most part. If you get something unusual, then you may need to send me the actual weed. But there's a lot of very common stuff that comes up every year. A lot of this stuff is coming up from seed, and they're annuals, and so they don't persist over the winter. They only come back up as from seed, and those are the easiest to control. The ones that are hard to control are those that grow from a rhizome and don't die out during the winter. They're perennial. So Bermuda grass is one of the most difficult weeds to control in a landscape. If you're growing it as a lawn, it's going to keep coming out of the lawn area and into your beds. Same with St. Augustine or Cocuyah grass. They're difficult to suppress if you're growing them as a lawn. They're going to keep coming in. But this is Weeds of California. Weeds of California as well. This is an older text, and it's published. Let's see who publishes it. Tell you the truth, I'm not sure who published it. Probably published by, who's the publisher? State of California Department of Agriculture. But this may be a pretty old book. I'm not sure how old it is, but this is a nice book that I've had for many years. But now I've got these modern books that are much bigger and really, really nice. Now there's also a nice section on weeds in the Sunset Western Garden book. On page 726, they've got a discussion of weeds. They list some of the more common weeds you're going to find in your garden. And they talk about ways to control them. And they also show one of the plants. Well, not I don't actually have the plant. I have got a different species, but in the same genus. And the nutsedges are particularly difficult to control because they make bulbs on their roots. So let's take a look at our... Let's just pull one up first and take a look at this. This is what is referred to as cheeseweed. It's a malva, and there's, let's take a look. Maybe we can go to the overhead, you can look at it. Now this is very close related actually to some other common garden plants. And let's see which one I have here. Here it is, common mallow, a blue mallow, little mallow, and high mallow, and they're all often referred to as cheeseweed, cheese plant, cheese dwarf mallow. There's a variety of them. I'm not sure which species this is. I haven't looked at it too closely. This comes up in my garden every year. You can recognize it mostly by the leaf and, of course, by the flower because it looks a lot like a little bit like a hibiscus flower. It's probably in the same family, almost certainly the Malvaceae, which is also the hibiscus family. And it often has a rust on it, on the back, that you often see on some other garden plants, indicating their close relationship. If they share a rust, that shows that they're really closely related. Now, this has a large taproot, and here's the taproot. It is an annual. It comes up, if it rains a lot in the winter, it'll come up in the winter. In the spring, it's going to take off and get pretty big. It's going to flower, make seed. The flowers are just starting right here. Here are the little flowers just starting. So the key to controlling all your annuals really is to pull them up before they bloom, before they make any seed. And if you can suppress them and prevent seed production, then you're going to greatly reduce the amount of work you have to put into to suppress them and keep them out of your garden. If you let them flower and make seed, boom, now instead of one, you've got 100. So this is cheeseweed, and let's just set this to the side. And cheeseweed's not all that hard to control. Here's another one. I pulled up a couple of them. Now this other one here is another very common weed in most people's gardens. Let's see if it's if I've got it here. Well, this is called sow thistle, and sow thistle is, of course, in the Asteraceae, or the, here it is here. Now, I want to show you, there's a couple things that'll tell you you've got sow thistle. One is that the stems are hollow, and that the other is that it produces a milky latex when you cut it. So I'm going to cut it here. It's well watered. It should make the white latex rather rapidly. Now, I'm going to hold this out here. I don't know if you can, yeah, you ought to be able to see that. See this white that's forming right here? You can also see that the stem is actually hollow. I don't know if you can see that it's hollow, but the stem is actually hollow. Let me see if I can cut it again. Cut it again. And the stem is hollow. Now at the nodes, it's closed. But so the two things that tell you you've got sow thistle are that it has these very large leaves that are deeply scalloped. See how they're deeply scalloped or lobed. And then when you cut into it, the stem is hollow, and it has a white milky latex that it makes. You can see the white on my finger there. So that'll tell you you got sow thistle. Now the key to controlling this is to, again, pull it up before it flowers. And I thought I had a second one with flowers on it. Maybe this one still is just producing its blooms. I cut the top of it out, which was where it would have its flowers. And I'm not sure where I put it. Oh, here it is. Here's the top. And here are the flowers are just starting to form on here. So this is the perfect time to pull this up because it hasn't gone to seed yet. Let's go to the top. You'll see if we go to, you see these flower buds are just starting to form. So this is when you want to get out and get your weeds pulled, or cut them down and cover them. Now, if you just break it off, this has a big taproot. There's the big taproot it's got right here. Let's see. I don't know if you can, all these leaves are getting in the way, so it's hard to see the taproot. Right here is, it's still got a lot of dirt on it, but here's the taproot coming all the way down. And so you want to pull this whole thing out. Now, the nice thing about this rain we just had is the soil's nice and soft. And so it's really easy to pull it up right now. If you let the soil dry out and dry over the next couple weeks and then try and pull it up, you're going to break it off. And of course, I've made a big mess. But that's what I do. Now, the other one here, this is called Chenopodium. And Chenopodium is a common, another annual weed that comes up from seed. And it's just starting to make its flowers. If we go to the overhead, you can see it. And take a look at what the leaves look like. Here are the leaves. So Chenopodium, there is a Chenopodium that people like to grow and use as a grain. This is just an invasive weed. This is, you know, a lot of these weeds also harbor viruses. And Chenopodium can have many different viruses in it. It's going to pick it up from aphids that feed on it. You know, it's spring. Now it's March. It rained and it's March. That means it's spring, even though it's not really spring until later in the month. But it's spring-like conditions. We're going to warm up. We're going to have a nice wet soil. Weeds are going to start growing like crazy. Aphids are going to start reproducing at very fast. So just in a few days or a week or so, you can all suddenly have aphids all over everything. They pick up viruses, maybe from weeds that survived the winter, and then infect the new plants. And then if you put in things like pepper, eggplant, tomatoes, beans, then those aphids are going to bring the viruses from your weeds into your vegetable garden. So, and we're going to talk more about IPM, integrated pest management, next Sunday, but this is kind of the heart of controlling various problems or pests in your landscape, is understanding the connection between, you know, weeds harboring viruses that aphids can collect or acquire by feeding on them, and then they're going to go to another plant and move that virus from into those plants. Now, you don't want the weeds anyway, so it's really important if you're preparing for your vegetable garden, and this is the time of year to really get out there and you know, get all the weeds out, turn the soil, mix in a lot of compost, mix in a pre-plant fertilizer, maybe mix in some gypsum, which is calcium sulfate, which is, you know, it's nice to have a high calcium level in your soil. It has a lot of benefits. And then you're going to get your vegetable garden in. Well, you don't want all these weeds growing all over your garden, because they are a good way to get viruses into your vegetables, particularly peppers. You know, peppers will really screw it up. Now, here's another weed. Here's another common weed. And I've got two clumps of it before we kind of go to our star weed. And here it is. This is oxalis. And when I was growing up, when I was a kid, growing up in the San Gabriel Valley in Pasadena area, we always called this sour grass. And the reason is these little shoots here with these, you know, really pretty yellow flowers. This is really a pretty, you know, it's a weed, it's invasive, but it's really pretty, and it only flowers and grows briefly in the spring. It's not that big a problem, but they have hollow stems here the stem for the flower, or the pedicel, is hollow. It's hard to see probably on the television, but that's hollow. And we used to eat this when we were kids, and it's sour. It's a little sour. It's not bad, actually. I ate that when I was growing up my whole life. Now, the thing about oxalis, this particular species of oxalis, and I'd have to look it up. I don't recall the exact species. And maybe I'll look it up when we go to a video in a minute. But these make, on their root systems, and here's a big taproot, they make little bulbs, and those bulbs are what come up in the spring. So the seed is not particularly important in this particular weed. You get all these bulbs along the root system. So even though I pulled this up, it left behind most of the root system. You see very few of the fine roots are here. And so there's a whole bunch of little bulbs that are formed on the root system. And so it's, you know, I'm not going to get rid of this just by pulling it up. It's going to come up year after year, even if I pull it up. And so you have to understand each weed, you know, to fully understand how to control it. Now, this last weed is probably one of the most common weeds we have here. This is called crabgrass. And now this is already fully flowered. Here are the flowers. Let me pull this over. I probably should have put out more newspaper because I've really made a mess on the table today. So here we go. Look at this. This is a perfect example of crabgrass. Now, this is also invasive in lawns. It'll really take over a lawn if you don't prevent it from growing. It comes up from seed. So again, you know, with an annual like this, how do you control it? Well, number one, get it out before these flowers. Here's a nice tiller right there. You see all these? This is all flowers. Now, these are immature. They haven't made any seed yet. So the key to keep this out of my garden is to go out there and get them all out in the next week, because these are almost ready to start making seed. Now, this is a big one that grew all winter. It was growing at the base of a fruit tree, and it was getting some water, because even though, you know, normally it would have rained, I wouldn't have needed to water my fruit trees during the winter. But, you know, in the absence of rain, I water about once a month. With my stone fruits that are deciduous, I only watered once during the whole winter. I didn't want the soil to go bone dry all winter without any water. Just keep the soil from going bone dry. So anyway, this is crabgrass. Here it's in the Sunset Western Garden Book. All these are in the Sunset Western Garden Book because they're so common. Crabgrass is, let me see, I'm going to get my pages all dirty. Trying to find it here. Crabgrass, Digitaria. And there's a handful of different species of Digitaria. I marked it in this book. And let's see what it has to say about it. Let me see if I can get this open to the right page. And there's a handful of different species. It's not all one species. Oh, this is the sow thistle. So anyway, this is crabgrass. It's very common. You see it all the time. And there are actually two different kinds of crabgrass. There is a hairy crabgrass and a smooth crabgrass. The hairy crabgrass has hairs all over the stems, and the smooth one is smooth. This one's smooth. If you feel it, it's absolutely smooth. There's no hairs on it. Plus, this one, even though this is pretty tall, these flower spikes are pretty tall, they're only about maybe 18 inches. The hairy crabgrass, these flower spikes can be as much as 24 inches, or maybe even close, probably, close to, 30 inches tall, much taller, much bigger. The hairy crabgrass is a bigger plant. I really don't know if I've seen it. This is the one that comes up in my garden year after year after year. Now, this next one is a sedge. And sedges are particularly difficult weeds to deal with. This one is actually grown usually as an ornamental, often in ponds or on the edges of wet areas. Its Cyperus is the genus. And I brought this in because it came into the lab, and one of our inspectors wanted to know, what is this? Is it invasive? Is it a problem? Well, many of the sedges are. And you can recognize sedges by this flower cluster here. Very, very common, and also the leaf. It's, sedges aren't that hard to recognize. There, that's a better picture. You can see this big clump of flowers at the top and these typical leaves for sedges. The worst one is the yellow nut sedge and the purple nut sedge, because on their roots they make nut sedge. They call it nut because on the root it makes a little bulb that makes a new plant. You pull up the plant, you get the whole root system, you think, but you've left behind all these little bulbs that form on the root system. And then you pull out one plant and you get five or six more grow where that plant was. So nut sedges are some of the most difficult to control, especially when they get into a lawn. There is a product called Sedge Hammer that people use for the nut sedges. I found repeated applications of Roundup will kill them as well. But I've mentioned this in the past about how I control weeds in my own garden. I put down cardboard and then I cover it with 4 inches of mulch. And for these annual weeds, that controls them, 99% of them. Very few will come up if you do that in an open area. Say you have fruit trees and you don't want to grow a lot, you want to suppress the weeds growing around your fruit trees, whether it's citrus or avocado or stone fruits. You want to put down a thick layer of mulch underneath the canopy of the tree and out in the areas between the trees to suppress weeds. And now if you don't have cardboard, you can use what's called building paper, which is a very brown, it's brown paper, it comes in a big roll. That works very well as well, but the key is the mulch. In fact, the mulch alone is very, very effective. So you put down a thick layer of mulch, it'll suppress weeds. You want to put that down usually twice a year. Right about now, you want to put down a thick layer of mulch. And then again in the fall, you want to put down a thick layer of mulch. When you plant your tomatoes and your peppers and you have them 3 feet apart, or with peppers, they don't have to be that far apart, but you have spacing between your plants, put down thick layers of mulch. It will suppress weeds and it'll conserve water. Conserve water. There's nothing more important than conserving water. So let's talk about water. Okay, there's a handful of, because, I just wanted to talk about these weeds. So let's just, before I move on to water, let me remind you. Pull your weeds early before they flower. When you're dealing with invasive weeds that have rhizomes like Bermuda grass, St. Augustine grass, Cocuyza grass, there's others, pulling them out will usually not eradicate them. And so I do use Roundup for Bermuda grass. Now, what I did was I put down the cardboard and the mulch, and that killed 95% of the Bermuda grass, but it came up on one side of the yard, a little spot over there, came up in a little spot over there. So I've got a little spray bottle with Roundup, and I just hit that Bermuda grass right where it's coming up, and right as soon as it comes up. And now with all this water, we're gonna get, it's gonna start coming up more. And here's the sourgrass, and it's sour. So let's talk about water now, because we've talked about it a lot. And water is so important. How you water is probably the number one issue in landscape maintenance. If you water improperly, you're wasting water. If you're watering too frequently and you're putting down too much. If you don't water enough, your plants will be drought stressed and they can be attacked by various pests that like to get on drought-stressed plant material, particularly, you know, large trees like pines, eucalyptus. If you don't water them at all, if you let them go dry all the time and we have a long drought, we've had basically a two-year drought right now, then they're going to be drought-stressed and they're going to be attacked by usually wood-boring insects, either bark beetles or wood borers. And once they get in the tree, you have very few options about what to do about a tree that's infested with a bark beetle or a wood-boring beetle or pest, because our insecticides will not penetrate the wood and kill those insects. But let's talk about water in general now. So there's some very important concepts in irrigation. Our first concept is what we call evapotranspiration. Evapotranspiration is the total water loss from the soil through the plant, which is transpiration, and from evaporation from the surface of the soil. We know historically that the ET rates for really all of North America, probably for the whole world for that matter, I've not looked at them over the whole world, I just look at them mostly for Southern California. So what are our ET rates in Southern California? Well, in the hot inland valleys, which is really most of Southern California, you lose an inch a week in the spring and the fall, and 2 inches a week in the summer. In the winter, you lose a half an inch a week. If you live right along the coast, Santa Monica, West LA, or you know San Diego, right up against the coast, you lose 3/4 of an inch a week in the spring and the fall, and an inch and a half a week in the summer. If you're out in the desert, you're gonna lose about, well, it changes rapidly. In the winter, you're gonna lose a half an inch. In fact, in the winter, all of Southern California loses a half an inch a week, whether you're in the desert or at the beach. It's a half an inch a week for everybody. In the desert, that quickly ramps up. In the spring, you'll pretty quickly get up to 2 inches a week. In the summer, you're going to get up to 3 inches a week. So the desert loses the most water compared to the inland valleys and compared to the coast. So now I have a little video talking about ET rates, and I'd like to go to that and have you take a look at that. Actually, our first video is how to test for landscape water needs or water waste, and that's really important, making sure that you're not wasting your water. Now, lawns will use up 3 to 4 feet of water per year to keep a lawn alive. That's a tremendous amount of water. Nothing else in your landscape is going to use that much water. Some people think pools use a lot of water. Pools don't use that much water. They got a lot of water in them, but they don't use a lot of water. They're just evaporating the water. Plants, on the other hand, draw the water out of the soil and use the water, and lawns use the most. Lawns are usually full sun. They're shallow rooted. They take a lot of water to keep them alive. So let's take a look at our first video, which is how to test for landscape water waste. Let's take a look at this video.
Hello, I'm Lawrence Budd. I'm an irrigation specialist with the Pasadena Water and Power Conservation Program. Welcome to our video on how to tune up your sprinkler system and measure your outdoor water use. I will guide you through how to measure your water use, show you where you might need improvements, and some better ways to water your lawn and garden. The first thing we're going to do is check for leaks around the house. A leaking toilet or sprinkler valve can waste hundreds of gallons of water every day. So first, check around the house and be sure all the water is shut off. A good way to see if you have any leaks is to simply look at your water meter. See the small black triangle in the middle? It turns for every tenth of a gallon. If it starts and stops, that's good. If it slowly creeps along all the time, that's bad. It means you might have a constant leak somewhere. When was the last time you watched your system run? Heads tend to get blocked, clogged, and broken. So first, let's walk around and see how this system's doing. I see a couple of things in this lawn right away. This brown spot is not caused by a lack of watering, but instead the head is plugged. Here's another one where the head is turned. It's keeping the sidewalk nice and clean, but missing the lawn. And here's one that is completely blocked by plants, preventing the water from reaching the lawn. Now you can buy extensions to raise these heads up, or you can simply cut back the plants, clearing the path for water to reach its intended area. The last most common problem is that the sprinkler head has the wrong nozzle, causing the water to shoot way over its intended area. So the first thing we did was to watch our system run. Then we straightened, unplugged, and unblocked any heads that are giving us problems. Now we're ready to measure the system's efficiency. To do this test, we're going to need 6 cans or cups, all the same size. I'm going to use these small plastic cups. We also need a ruler and a pencil. As you can see, I'm setting up the cups out in the middle of the lawn, in the main watering zone. Try to set them within one zone if you can, and not too close to the heads. Now I'm going to turn the zone on for 10 minutes. We'll see a lot of things happening as it runs. First, the cups are obviously catching water, but some other things are happening as well. Do you see the mist in the air? This tells us that the water pressure is too high and should be turned down. And over here, the zone has only been on for a minute or so, and already we have water running off the lawn. It's sad to know that landscape runoff is the largest single cause of water waste in Southern California. After running the zone for 10 minutes, gather up the cups and lay them out so we can measure the amount of water in each one. Take a ruler and stick it in each cup. We can see that 2 of them have about 1/3 of an inch, 2 have about 1/2 an inch, and 2 have almost none. We're not done yet. Write down the amount of water in each cup. The 2 almost empty ones tells me that this area is not getting enough water, and that means low uniformity. You end up overwatering the entire area just to get these areas wet enough. The right thing to do is to correct the nozzle size or unplug the head so these areas get wet faster. Now we're going to combine all of the cups into one. Grab your ruler again and measure the depth of the water. This is how much water we are applying each hour. In this case, it is roughly 2 inches per hour. That's a lot. Is that good? Well, no, but it's very common. Your soil absorbs water at about 0.2 to 0.6 inches per hour, a whole lot less than the 2 inches per hour we're watering at. So what happens when you water this fast? That's right, you get water runoff. There are guides available to help you set your controller for the correct amount of water based on the kinds of sprinkler heads you have. For more information, please visit our website at PasadenaSavesWater.com.
So, you know, his point is really important, that soils will absorb water at most about 1/2 an inch an hour. Most pop-up lawn sprinklers apply at about 2 inches an hour. And that is the fundamental reason why we get so much runoff off of lawns, is because we're applying it too fast. The pop-up spray heads are applying too much water in a short period of time. Now, generally, a 15-minute runtime gives you about 1/2 an inch. Most lawns should be watered about 1/2 an inch each time you water them. If you can get away with watering a whole inch once a week in the spring and the fall, that's fine. And then in the summer, you can apply about 1.5 to 1.75 inches a week. Now, different grasses need different amounts of water, and that's the next concept in irrigation. We talked about ET rates. The next concept is crop coefficient. The crop coefficient is a percentage of ET that a plant or a species needs. The tall fescues need 80% of the ET rate, and that's about the most in a landscape. Now, vegetables will give you your highest yield at 120% of ET, but lawns, in order to keep them alive, you got to give them 80%. So that would mean 0.8 inches a week in the spring and the fall in a hot inland valley, and 1.6 inches a week in the hot inland valley. Now, the thing about lawns is they're not very deep rooted, maybe 6 to 12 inches, and that upper profile dries out rapidly. And so you need to reapply the water fairly frequently. Usually in the spring, in the fall, that's twice a week. In the summer, it's up to 3 times a week. Now, if you can get away with applying it twice a week and your lawn does well, that's even better, to give it a deeper soak, try and get deeper rooting. That's really good. But typically, when it gets really hot, over 100 degrees in an inland valley, you're going to need to water almost every other day. And you have to put down at least 1/2 an inch each time you water. Now, those pop-up spray heads are very common, but there's much better heads nowadays that are on the market. And you just take off your old heads and put on the new ones. And they have these little fingers that rotate like this. And they often apply at about a half an inch an hour or even less. Now you're going to have to adjust your run time. If it's a half an inch an hour and you want to put down a half an inch, you're going to have to run that system for 1 hour. So that's the really key thing. So we talked about ET rate, we talked about your a crop coefficient. The next thing is your application rate, which is we've kind of already talked about. How many inches per hour are you watering your landscape? Because we measure how you water, we measure it by the inch, just the way we measure rainfall. So you either put down an inch, you put down 2 inches, you put down 3 or 4 inches. When you're watering a citrus tree, you're going to want to put down 3 to 4 inches of water when you water that citrus tree to soak the soil to a depth of 2 to 3 feet. Then you're not going to water it again for a month. Citrus have a crop coefficient of 2/3 or 66% of the ET rate. That means they need roughly, let's just round it off to 3/4 to 75% because it's just easier. And this isn't rocket science. This is, you just want to be in the ballpark. You don't want to waste water. You don't want to drought stress your plants. You want to be close to what you exactly need. So if you're watering citrus and you give them, in March this month, we lose an inch a week, 4 inches for the month. So you don't need to give it 100% of ET. You don't have to give it 4 inches, but 3 inches is 75%. So in March, you should water your citrus long enough to put down 3 inches of water. If you've got pop-up spray heads like you use for lawns, you'd have to run that system for about an hour and a half. In an hour, you get 2 inches, another half hour, you get another inch. So you get about 3 inches in an hour and a half. That's, again, a very high application rate, and you may have a lot of runoff, but roughly that's how you would water a citrus tree. And you just do it once in March, March, April, May, June, you might move it up to about 4 inches. Now, once we get into July, August, September, when it gets hot, let's talk about, just continue with citrus, you're going to need to water that. It loses 8 inches a month because 2 inches a week in the summer, and you need to give it about 3/4 or 66%. If you are growing, if you had 100 acres of citrus, you'd give it 66%, not 3/4. If you got one orange tree in your backyard, it's not going to break you to give it a little extra water. But if you're a grower, that little extra water is your profit. So it's really important not to give it too much water. So generally speaking, for citrus, you're going to water it every 2 to 3 weeks in the summer. And every time you water it, again, you're going to give it 3 or 4 inches of water. So say you give it 3 inches of water twice a week. That's 6 inches for the month in July, September, August. August, September, I got the months turned around there. July, August, September. And then October, you're going to go back to watering once a month for citrus. And this is generally true of all your fruit trees except some of the tropicals. Avocados, you're probably going to have to water them even twice a month in the spring. Maybe March once a month. May, go to 3 weeks. March, April, May, you'd go to 3 weeks. June, you'd do start the 2 week schedule. July, you could probably continue with 2 weeks, but August and September, if we get really hot, you're going to have to water once a week because they're tropicals, they need more water. Now, I've got another video I want to show you on ET rates so we can reinforce this evapotranspiration rate. Let's take a look at this video on ET, your evapotranspiration rate.
A lawn loses water through evapotranspiration, also referred to as ET rate. Basically, the ET rate tells how many inches of water a typical lawn uses through surface evaporation. ET is calculated based on temperature, humidity, wind, and sunshine. The amount of water lost through ET is replenished by either rainfall or your sprinkler system. Once you know the application rate of your sprinkler system, you can use the ET rate in your area to set your sprinkler for the exact amount of water required to keep your lawn healthy and green. With an internet search of ET rate in your area, you can find the information you need. We are setting our sprinkler system to water every 3 days. So we are adding together the ET rate for the last 3 days. 0.15 plus 0.18 plus 0.17 of an inch gives us a total of a half an inch of water needed for this cycle. Our system delivers 1.5 inches of water per hour. So a 20-minute cycle will deliver a half an inch of water. the exact amount our lawn needs. For more tips on how to save water in and around the house, log on to our website and always...
So, if he's losing a half an inch in 3 days, that's roughly an inch a week, he probably is in Pasadena in March. So, but he could be anywhere in the United States for that matter. And you can find your ET rates exactly the way he said to do it. You can find them on the internet. Now, so we've talked about your ET rate. We talked about the species coefficient. And, you know, generally speaking, you know, like for citrus, I said it's 66%, and that's year-round. But some plants, their ET rates change, particularly stone fruits, deciduous fruit trees. In the spring, in March, right now, most of my fruit trees, most of my stone fruits, my peaches, plums, nectarine, they have no leaves. So they're not using very much water. The ET rate for a peach in March is going to be about 50%. It needs about half the water that's lost from the soil on a daily, weekly, monthly basis. And it only needs it once a month. So if we're losing an inch a week, 4 inches a month, we're going to water it once during the month, you're going to give it about 2 inches in March. And then, you know, you can continue to do that, you know, 2 inches probably in April, 2 inches in May, once a month. You might go to 3 inches because it really takes about 3 inches to soak a soil deep. And your goal is to soak the soil deep and then let it dry out for several weeks, 2 to 4 weeks. But once stone fruits are fully leafed out in the summer, for maximum yield, the ET rate goes over 100%. So when you're watering peaches in the summer, you're going to want to probably give it about 4 inches every 2 weeks. So we're losing 2 inches a week, 8 inches for the month in July, August, September. These are averages. It's a little different, you know, depending on where you exactly live. But roughly, you know, lose 8 inches on the month. You want to give it about 100% of ET because that's how you want to get good yield. So you're going to water it about 4 inches twice a month. Give it a good deep soak. So I think we've covered a lot of those concepts, but let's take a look at some of the literature that's available on water, and there's a whole library full of it. Let's go to the overhead, and I'll show you some of the things. You can find these quite easily on the internet. You don't have to print them out if you want to save paper and ink. But this is from a lawn watering guide for California. This is from the University of California Agricultural and Natural Resources. And one of your best sources, especially for California, is the University of California. So step one, it says determine what type of lawn you have. And this is important because Bermuda's and St. Augustine's, their crop coefficient is 60%. For the tall fescues like Marathon and Medallion, it's 80%. So those are cool season, you know, the tall fescues are cool season grasses. The St. Augustine and Bermuda are warm season grasses. They use less water. Then it says here, determine the output of your sprinklers. We saw that on the video. You put cups or cans or coffee cups on your lawn, run the system for some period of time, 10 minutes or 15 minutes, measure the depth in the cups, use 5 or 6 cups, and then take an average and multiply times 4, and then you'll know how many inches per hour you're applying. And then determine how many minutes you need to water your lawn each week. And I'll tell you this, for most of us, if you water your lawn for 15 minutes with a standard irrigation system that is applying at about 2 inches an hour, you get a half an inch. You really are, in general, putting down about a half an inch each time you water your lawn. But add that up. You do that an inch a week in the spring and the fall and 2 inches a week in the summer. That adds up to about 48 inches, and that's 4 feet of water. That's a tremendous amount of water. Now they have a map. Let's go back to the top, and they have different, this publication shows all these different zones around California. And Southern California Inland Valleys is 10. And so knowing where you're at, it shows, let's stay on, and I'll go through this publication. These tables are for each region, Northern California coast, Northern Inland Valleys. I know you can't read this on the TV, but let's skip to 10. And here's 10, Southern California Inland Valleys. And it says warm season turf grasses. And it says in January, if you're applying it a half an inch an hour, you need to run it for 42 minutes. and that's going to give you a little less than a half an inch, you know. And then, so if you're applying at 2 inches an hour, you run it for 10 minutes. January, you don't need very much water. And these are warm season turf grasses, cool season. But let's take a look in July. And if you're applying at 2 inches an hour, you run it for 55 minutes per week. That's how much you run it per week. So that would give you almost a full 2 inches so you can get this, and then you can figure out exactly how to water your lawn. This is an excellent publication to understand how to water your lawn. A lot of people call me up, and they've got a default setting on their control panel, and it goes on every day for 10 minutes. That's not how you water anything. That's a default setting in case you lose power, you lose your program, and it just keeps your landscape alive until you can go reprogram your control panel for your automated sprinkler system. That doesn't mean you're supposed to water your landscape 10 minutes every day year round. Now let's take a look at this next publication, and this gets a little more complicated, and this is really meant for professionals more than it is for homeowners, but this is the guide to estimating irrigation water needs of landscape plantings in California. The landscape coefficient method and this is Wuchols 3, but the landscape coefficient method, I know that you can't read that, and this is quite extensive, but the really nice thing about this is it has at the back of it, basically, it says whether they are low water use, medium water use, or high water use plants. It gives you a very long list of almost anything you could grow or think of growing in California. And it tells you whether it's low, medium, or high, and depending on where you live as well. So this is really an excellent resource for understanding what is a drought-tolerant material that has low water needs, what is moderate water needs, and what is high water needs. Now, lawns are always high water needs. Other things that are high water needs, ferns, fuchsias, things like that. Moderate water needs, fruit trees and citrus are moderate. Low, of course, cactus, rosemary, very low water needs. Native plants, you can let them go dry almost all summer. They won't look so great, but you can let them go dry. So you can get this on the internet. Just type in estimating irrigation water needs of landscape plants in California. You'll find this. If you don't want to print it out, which you probably don't because it's about, I don't know how many pages it is, 150 pages. It's a lot of pages. But it's got that wonderful table in the back that's going to give you, instead of actual crop coefficients, it's taken the crop coefficients and put them into three categories. So 10% to 30% is low water, 30% to 60% is moderate, and above 60% is high. So it breaks it down into a kind of a simpler way to look at that. Now let's see what else we've got here. People call in and ask me questions about their gardens, and I often tell people to kill their lawn. Get rid of your lawn. Especially your front lawn. All you do is walk past it in the morning on the way to work and walk past it in the evening when you're coming home. You don't really utilize that area to grow interesting plant material. You probably hire someone to come in and mow it once a week. Get rid of it. Go to a low water use ground cover, and you don't have to have somebody, a mow and blow, come in and mow it every week. You don't have to water it to death 2-3 times a week. You don't have to fertilize it very much. And so, you know, you can go to ice plants, you can go to Diamondia, all sorts of ground covers that only need to be watered once a month in the spring and the fall, and maybe every 2 to 3 weeks in the summer. And you can have an interesting landscape instead of this boring grass. So anyway, I'm ranting and raving. But, you know, in that vein, I do have another video that is from Long Beach, California, where you can be paid to tear out your lawn. And no matter where you live, you should look into this, because almost every water district, every agency that provides water to a community now has programs where they'll pay you per square foot to get rid of your lawn. So let's take a look at this video clip from Long Beach, the completion of the 500th lawn removal project. So they took out 500 lawns. Drive down the street. It's lawn after lawn after lawn. Envision that being covered with 4 feet of water, 3 to 4 feet of water. It's so much water. Let's get rid of our lawns. Let's go to this video and look at this celebration on the 500th removal of a lawn in Long Beach. And it was several years ago, so they've taken out more since then.
Proud today that you have done this, and I want to thank you personally for doing this. It's, aside from it being beautiful, no one will know that it's actually a water conservation strategy, and you've ripped up lawns to do it. The nice thing about this is it appears as though it was by choice. It's an aesthetic choice you've made, as opposed to really one would meet our water conservation goals. We have pumping restrictions on imported water supplies from the Sacramento San Joaquin Delta. They remain in place and have permanently reduced the amount of water that comes to Southern California. So even when we have a great water year, we are working from a place of permanent reductions in water supply. So it's never going to be from drought to abundance, drought to abundance. We are always in a permanent reduced state.
In terms of water conservation and the connection to businesses, right, this is a residential program currently, but truthfully it's a mindset issue. If you have the entire collective of Long Beach as a collective of residents that pronounce that wasting water in the lawns, wasting water anywhere is not acceptable, it's not really part of our culture of who we are as Long Beach, I think that's just, it's a cultural statement, and businesses do benefit.
And you know, one of the things that we're hoping and starting to emerge, but there's still a lot of opportunity, is for, you know, because Long Beach is providing such leadership in this, and there's such a market here for landscape architects and irrigation experts and such to really build a business around this right here in Long Beach, because clearly Long Beach is the leader in this arena. So landscape architects and irrigation companies that do efficient irrigation.
I love the appearance of my landscape before I did this, and now every time I pull up, I'm just in awe at how much better it is than it even was before. Every day I come home, it seems like something has changed. I'm watching hummingbirds and butterflies, and even getting squirrels, and I didn't have squirrels before. They're burying nuts in my mulch. And you know, I think that if more residents participate in this, we're gonna be able to have much greater reduction in water use, and I think that our communities are gonna actually be more beautiful.
So just some of the plants I saw in those pictures, they're easily available. You can get them at any nursery. I saw blue chalk, which is Senecio. It's got little blue fingers. It looks like an ice plant. It's not really an ice plant. It's in the sunflower family, the Asteraceae, a beautiful sunflower behind me. But so I saw blue chalk. I saw blue fescue, which is that clumping blue grass. I saw kangaroo paw, which is really, really cool and very drought tolerant. And it comes up with these really cool little flowers. I saw rosemary. I saw prostrate rosemary. You know, all this stuff is out there and available. It's easily purchased. Thick layers of mulch. Mulching can reduce water use by a third in a vegetable garden. So lots of mulching to suppress the weeds. We looked at the weeds earlier today. And then drought-tolerant plants. Those were young landscapes. They'd just been planted. When you come back in 5 or 10 years, a lot of those plants are going to grow up and cover those areas, and it's going to be a beautiful landscape. If you have a question about your landscape or your garden, give me a call at 1-800-339-1193. Now let's talk about insects, because that's what's going to start happening right now, is we're going to see a lot of insects getting onto your plants. There's a broad range of insects, of course. Insects are the most numerous group. There are more species of insects than any other class of animal. Just the beetles alone, which is one order within the class, probably 1.5 million species of beetles. Think about plants. How many species of plants are there? Maybe 500,000? there's 1.5 million species of just beetles. So the insects dwarf all the other organisms on Earth in terms of diversity and number of species and the things they do. Our lives are intricately intertwined with insects, whether they're eating our plants, whether they're pollinating our plants, whether they're eating our houses like termites, or they're biting us and vectoring diseases in people, vectoring diseases in plants. So there, in terms of a landscape and controlling insect pests, there's two broad groups of insects, and not taxonomically, but how they feed. So how do insects feed? They either have a long, skinny mouth that they puncture plants with and suck the juices out, so they're sucking insects, or they're chewing insects. They sit there and eat the leaves. And so those are two broad ways that insects eat plants. Let's start off by talking about the most common of all the sucking insects, aphids. Aphids are also known as plant lice. Let's bring up our first picture of aphids. If you've never seen an aphid before, that means you've never gone out and looked at a plant in spring before. And so they are, of course, very small plant-eating insects, and bring this up full screen and take a good look at them. Now, aphids are among the most destructive of all insect pests on cultivated plants. There are about 4,400 species in 10 families. Many aphid species are monophagous. That means they feed on only one plant species. Others across many families. So some aphids will feed on almost any plant. Others will feed on only one plant. With 4,400 species, you can imagine that's not hard to achieve. And aphids passively feed on the sap in the phloem. Now, there's two different types of vascular tissue in plants. There's xylem, which is the wood of a plant, and it conducts the water in the plant. And then there's the phloem. The phloem conducts the sugar that's made in the leaves, and it distributes it to growing points. So in the spring, on a tree, there's stored food in the roots and the branches and the trunk, and it is solubilized and then moved in the phloem up to the growing points. Then during the rest of the year, as the leaves start making sugar, it flows down. So in the spring, the sap flows up the tree, and in the summer, in the fall, it flows down the tree and is stored, or it goes to flowers and fruit to make those. And aphids feed on the phloem, or the sugary material in the phloem, and they can drip it out their rear ends, and that's called honeydew, and it's sticky. And if you notice on plant leaves in your garden, if you're looking at a plant and it's sticky and it's shiny, or if it's got black growing all over the leaf and you rub it and it comes right off, that indicates honeydew and you have a sucking insect problem. Usually aphids, but there's many of them. And so so they actually, there's lots of sugar in the phloem, but there's not a whole lot of nitrogen, and they need nitrogen to make protein. So they actually have to get more of that sap to get enough nitrogen. That's why it flows right through them and drips off their rear end. And this is an important factor, because that honeydew that drips off them is collected by ants, particularly Argentine ants, but other ants too. And those ants will protect the aphids. Let's take a look at our next picture of aphids. This first one was on a rose, and this next one is the rose aphid itself. And then this next picture, let's take a look at our next picture, which is ants that tend to, bring it up full screen. And you can see these ants. I'm not sure what species of ant this is, but you can see here are the aphids, and here are the ants. And they're collecting the honeydew, and they're protecting them. So if a ladybug beetle comes around and wants to eat these aphids, the ants will attack the ladybug beetle and knock it off the plant. They'll also bring aphids up from the ground and put them on the plant. They actually treat them like we treat cattle or any other animal we use. So aphids, not that hard to control, but another thing about aphids is they don't need males to reproduce. The females can lay their eggs without being mated, and they can lay lots and lots of eggs, and then they just turn into females. And so you can rapidly increase the population, literally in days, going from a few to thousands. That's called parthenogenesis, is the ability of females to lay eggs without being mated. And it has to do with their genetics. The females are probably, you know, haploid. And then when the males come in, they actually lay other types of eggs. Mealybugs. Mealybugs are extremely common. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is number four, the long-tailed mealybug. Bring that up full screen. Now, mealybugs are what we call, they aren't armored scale. There's different kinds of scale, and we'll talk about scale, but this is actually a scale insect. But mealybugs are usually recognized as a specific group, and they are sexually dimorphic, meaning that the sexes have distinct morphological differences. So, and mealybugs they don't go through full metamorphosis. So little ones look like adults. They do not undergo complete metamorphosis, and there are no clear larval or pupal or adult stages. So the babies look like the adults, and they just get bigger and bigger and bigger. Let's take a look at our next one, which is the Taxus mealybug. Bring that up full screen. I want you to get a good look at it, because mealybugs really take off. And our next one is the citrus mealybug. And let's take a look at that. Here's citrus mealybug, and here are some ants tending them. So when you're trying to control a lot of these insects, it's important to actually control the ants too. Now, I want to show you this next picture, bring it up too, which is the mealybug destroyer. And you see this? This looks a lot like a mealybug. And you see all these here? These are either scale or there's something. I'm not sure what that is on here. That looks like a scale insect. And mealybugs are. But this is actually the larva of a beetle. And it looks like a mealybug, but mealybugs don't move very fast. They don't really move at all. They just sit there sucking on the plant, and they feed on the phloem just like aphids do. And they drip honeydew. But this one here, moves rapidly. He's wandering around. He's wandering around looking for something to eat. And so if you see this on your plant and he's moving, it's not a mealybug. And I found these one time on a gardenia, and there were hundreds of them, probably hundreds. And I noticed how quickly they were walking around. And I thought, that's kind of odd, because mealybugs just sit there and feed. They don't move. So I brought it in and showed it to our entomologist in the department. I said, oh, that's the mealybug destroyer. It's a predator of mealybugs. And now that's the larva stage that we looked at. In the adult stage, it looks like a ladybug beetle. It is a beetle, but it's pure black. And both the adult and the larval stages are predators on other insects, particularly mealybugs. And so it's called the mealybug destroyer. I once had an individual call into the lab and say, you know, send in a sample, and called in and said, what were those? And I said, well, those are beneficials. Don't spray them. She goes, well, I already sprayed them. So this actually goes to IPM, which we're going to talk about next week in more depth, is correct identification of your pest. If you are identifying an insect on a plant, you want to make sure that you've identified it correctly as to what it is. Because if you go reach for a bottle of a broad-spectrum insecticide and spray the plant, you might have just killed a predator that was actually controlling a pest. So it's very important to correctly identify your pest. And I've asked this of students in the past. What is the first step in pest control? Correct identification. What's the first step in disease control? Correct diagnosis of the disease. If you don't know what's wrong, how do you know what you're doing, the action you take, is going to be beneficial or detrimental or just benign? You're just wasting your time and spinning your wheels and wasting your money, and you're not doing anything. Or you could be putting on something that's actually detrimental. So number one, correct identification of the pest or diagnosis of the disease. So we looked at mealybugs. Now, scale insects are another group of insects. Let's see if we know more about mealybugs. Now, the males of mealybugs are very short-lived, and they do not feed at all as adults and only live to fertilize females. Very unfair. The most serious pests are mealybugs that feed on citrus and other species damage sugarcane, grapes, pineapple, coffee, cassava, ferns, cacti. I get a lot of mealybug on my cactus, and if I don't control them quickly, they'll scar the cactus and they'll make it, you know, they'll hurt the appearance. And if you leave them on long enough, they really do quite a bit of damage. Now, mealybugs only tend to be serious pests in the presence of ants, because the ants protect them from predators and parasites. And I want to reemphasize the importance of controlling Argentine ant in a landscape if you want to control these sucking insects. Scale insects. Let's look at our first scale insect picture. These are barnacle scale. Now, barnacle scale, bring that up full screen. This is actually a native scale. I see it quite often on natives like Ceanothus or Toyon. There are about 8,000 species of scale insects identified and described. Scale insects are very dramatically in their appearance, from very small, 1 to 2 millimeters, under wax covers, some look like oyster shells, to shiny pearl-like objects about 5 millimeters, to creatures covered with mealy wax. So adult female scales are almost always immobile. A scale don't move at all. They secrete a covering that covers their body. So you actually have to pry that off and dissolve it in order to see the adults. So they're very, very odd looking. And so they are permanently attached to the plant. They have parasitized. And scale insects are among the most difficult of insects to control. And there's two stages to scales. One stage for scale is the adult stage, where they're just sitting there. The other is the crawler stage, because they'll get filled with eggs, the eggs will hatch, and they'll come out and start walking around the plant. That's the most opportune time to hit them with a spray, either an oil or a soap or a broad spectrum insecticide, depending on what you select. And I gotta tell you, scale are so difficult to control that usually, especially if you have a heavy infestation, you're gonna be forced to use some type of broad spectrum insecticide, something like 7 or malathion, something that's really gonna knock down the adults. Because when you spray with oils and soaps, you're not gonna kill the adults. They're protected by that covering, and so that's why they're difficult to control. Scale are difficult to control because they're protected from the environment by the integument that they secrete that covers them. But you can get the crawlers before they settle down and make that. Scale insects, our waxy covering makes them quite resistant to pesticides, which are only effective against the first instar nymph called the crawler stage. Adult males have wings but never feed and die within a day or two. Again, very unfair. Now, whitefly. Let's take a look at a few other scales that are common. Now, a lot of scales are very host-specific. You only get it on one type of plant. And this next one is cycad scale. Bring this up full screen. Now, cycads are a very popular plant material in Southern California. There's sago palms. Dione is a good genus that people grow. Encephalartos. We're going to talk about more of those in the future. We can see all these scales all over here. And what you don't see is, if you flip this over, wherever there's a scale, there's a yellow spot on the leaf, and it's pretty much permanent. Even if you come back later and spray, you're going to have little yellow dots all over the leaves, and it's kind of a permanent damage to the plant, and these are ornamentals. You want them to look nice. There's very low tolerance of damage in ornamentals. If you can put up with a little few yellow spots on tomatoes, you still get lots of tomatoes. But if you've got, an ornamental plant, you don't want it to look poorly. It's meant to look wonderful. So, in our next, we have another one, which is the red date scale. Bring that up, and this will get in between the leaves this junk you see in here is from the red date scale, and here are the scales too. So, again, scales are very hard to control, and you need to get on them right away. Now, another very interesting scale is the cochineal scale. And let's look at our next picture. This is Opuntia cactus, or prickly pear cactus, or beaver tail cactus. Opuntia is a genus with about 40 species or so of cactus. Many of them are native to the southwestern United States, if not all of them, actually. And it gets this white, fluffy stuff on the pads, on the leaves. And people call up and they think they have a fungal infection. In fact, that's not uncommon when people have mealybug or scale, that they think that they've got a fungus, because it's all white and fluffy, and they think anything white and fluffy must be a fungus. In fact, it's an insect. Now, this one is a native scale insect that gets on a native cactus, and if you scrape it off and squish it, it's bright red, or almost a blood red, purple almost. And let's take a look at a heavy infestation on our next picture, number 12. That's kind of a light infestation. Bring this up full screen. You can see how heavy this is on this Opuntia. It's just covered with it. It's just everywhere. All this is solid, solid on it. And it will scar the epidermis. You see, the pad right there looks real clean. When you wash all this off, it's going to be scarred underneath. So cochineal scale was used as a dye. Because you squish it and it's red, if you collect a bunch of it and put it in water and squish it all up and put it in the water, then you can put a cloth in there and dye it. If you put a little bit of cochineal scale in there, it'll be pink. If you put a whole bunch in there, you can dye it all the way to red. And in fact, it was the basis for a whole industry. People used to go out and collect this off of cactus, probably around 1900, right around the turn of the century, in 1900, 1910, right in that area, and collect it, and then it was used to dye clothing. Well, with the introduction of synthetic dyes, that whole industry died out. But we still have cochineal scale, and it's an interesting scale. It only goes, I've never seen it on anything but opuntia, on prickly pear or beaver tail cactus. So it's not hard to control. You can wash it off with a strong stream of water, or you can spray it with oil. You can spray it with soap. This is one of the scales that's not that hard to control. It's not an armored scale, it's a soft scale. Soft scales are much easier to control compared to armored scales. But you probably need to spray fairly frequently over several weeks, once a week for 2, 3, 4 weeks, and really clean it up. If you want to get a really fast cleanup, you can hit it with a broad spectrum insecticide. 7, malathion, orthine, a lot of them out there. Let's see if we have another scale. We don't. Let's go on to whiteflies. Now, whiteflies is another interesting group of sucking insects. They are, of course, flies, so they're in the order Diptera, and there are more than 1,550 species described. Bring this up full screen. A lot of times, they don't really look like whiteflies. This is actually the black pupal stage of a whitefly. These are the pupal stages, and this is actually a whitefly. And you might mistake this for being like a mealybug. The feeding damage can cause economic losses. It is the ability of whiteflies to transmit or spread viruses that has the widest impact on global food production. And in fact, whiteflies vector some really devastating viruses in lettuce. And you can get so many whiteflies that there's just a cloud of them flying in the air. And if you breathe, you're going to breathe them in. I see we have a caller. Let's go to our next caller. Who do we got?
Hello?
Hello? You're on the air. Oh, Terry.
I have a question about with this rain we've been having. I wanted to know how long do I have before I wait before I water again with all my grass and trees. I was wondering how long do I have to wait?
Well, that's a great question because we got a very, very heavy rainfall. Probably 4 to 5 inches downtown. And in the valleys, we might have gotten even more than that, but that was a good soaking. So for a lot of your trees, you're not going to need to water for about 4 weeks, depending on how quickly we warm up or if we get more rain. So all this is based on the weather. Let's talk about lawns. Certainly, you don't need to water your lawn for at least 7 days with this type of a soaking. And probably you won't need to water your lawn for about 10 to 14 days. If we stay cool and overcast, or if we certainly get any more rain, you will not need to water your lawn for about 2 weeks. Even if it's a tall fescue that uses a lot of water, we're not that warm. The soil is soaked deep, and your lawn should easily be fine for 10 to 14 days. For fruit trees, certainly 4 weeks. If you have citrus or stone fruits, which don't need a lot of water this time of year because they don't have a lot of leaf, you will not need to water again until April. And so this is great for anyone who has fruit trees. This deep water, perfect timing, right at the beginning of spring, right at the beginning of March, that's your whole water need for all of March we got in the last 3 to 4 days.
That's great. That's good news.
And even big shade trees, things like elms and oaks and sycamores, you probably won't need to water them until April, or perhaps, even longer, maybe 6 weeks. If we get more rain, which is likely because the jet stream has moved south and is coming right across Southern California, And we may see more rain. I haven't looked at the long-term forecast, whether we see more rain in a week or 2 weeks, but I'll bet you we get another storm. If we get another storm, you can add another week for your lawn, and you could probably add another 2 weeks to 4 weeks for your trees, especially if we get another soaking in 2 to 3 weeks, then you won't need to water your citrus until May. So good soak, turn off your automated sprinkler system for at least a week, and probably for 2 weeks.
Oh, okay. All right, well, thanks a lot. Thanks for that information.
Okay, well, thank you for calling. Thank you for watching the show. So yeah, that's a good question. You know, how long do you wait after a good storm to water? I would not water my lawn again for 2 weeks. Do we have another caller? No, we don't. So, good question. Let's talk more about whiteflies. One of the big problems with whiteflies is that they can move viruses into important crops, particularly lettuce and the brassicaceae. So let's take a look at some whiteflies. Here we see one type of whitefly. Let's look at our next picture, which is the giant whitefly. Bring this up full screen because this shows, oh, we lost it. Where we go? Here we go. So here are the adults. Now the thing about whiteflies is wherever they walk, they leave wax, and they are covered with wax. And they can be a little difficult to control because of this heavy wax coating they have on them. Now the giant whitefly is native to Mexico. It will go to quite a few hosts, but is particularly bad on hibiscus and a few other shrubs like xylosma. I've seen it on avocado and citrus, but it doesn't do that well on those. But it makes these long hairs. The nymphs, or the larva stage, make long waxy filaments that hang down. Now you don't see it so much, but look at our next picture. And you can see these very long hairs. You see all these hairs. This is wax. And there's adults down in here too. Now if you shake the bush, you'll see all these little white flies fly all over the place. And you'll know you've got white fly. Now there is a parasitoid wasp that is doing a pretty good job of controlling giant white fly. And you'll often notice where the adults have walked. Wherever the adult walks on the leaf, it leaves a trail of wax. You'll often see these concentric circles, or you might see them on the edge of the leaf. It's all covered with a white waxy material. Let's take a look at our next picture. These are whitefly adults. They're just little white flies. You shake them, and they take off and fly. One of the ways that years ago, when I was mowing lawns, one of my customers said the way she gets rid of her white flies, or at least tries to suppress the population, because it's not going to get rid of all of them, is she would take a big piece of newspaper and roll it up into a long thing, light the end on fire, shake the bush, and then flash the flame underneath and just kill all the ones that flew. I don't know how effective that is, but it was pretty, I guess, clever in a way, although I think a little hazardous. But so we can see these adult whiteflies in this picture. And let's take a look at our next picture, which shows the concentric rings that you often find from whiteflies when they walk around. Let's take a look at number 17. Here, bring that up full screen. So this is a whitefly trail. And it started here in the middle. It's hard to see exactly where it walked, but here, I must have changed directions at some point and done this. And here, it probably flew away. But if you see this, you know you've got whitefly, even though the adult's gone. So this tells you you've got whitefly. And there's a whole variety. There are many, many whiteflies. There's a nesting whitefly, and there's the giant whitefly. There's many, many. There's a crown whitefly that gets on oaks. It's a native whitefly. Some years you see a lot of them, some years you don't see very much. That's very typical of insects. So just another interesting thing about whiteflies. In 1997, tomato yellow leaf curl virus discovered in the USA and Florida. The plant disease is the worst viral disease of tomato. The disease is transmitted by the whitefly Bemisia argentifolii. So whiteflies can be really devastating. Now, just to digress briefly about viruses in plants, most viruses are vectored by insects. aphids are the number one vector of viruses, but white flies can vector them. Other insects can vector viruses. And usually you cannot control viral diseases in plants by attacking the vector, because you need almost 100% eradication of the insect vector in order to really reduce the disease in the plant. And so, how do you control viruses in plants? Number one, you use plants that are resistant, because resistant plant material is the way you control diseases. Number one, always. Number one means to controlling plant disease, resistant plant material. When you talk about viruses, it's reducing the inoculum that's available in the environment that the insects feed on to acquire the virus. So if you're growing a crop of tomatoes and you've got 10 acres of tomatoes or whatever your acreage is, and on the edges you've got all these weeds. You've got cheeseweed. You've got chenopodium. You've got all these weeds growing. Maybe you have some old tomatoes that came up that made it through the winter, that overwintered, and they're virused. Now the aphids pick up the virus from the weeds and introduce it into the crop. So controlling weeds becomes an extremely important aspect of controlling viruses in vegetable production, or really almost any plant material. It's really, really important. Now, another group of insects that are a real problem are thrips. And let's take a look at thrips. This next picture is thrips on spice bush. Thrips are, of course, little tiny insects. They're hard to see. So you, often when you want to try and identify an insect, you want to have a magnifying glass, or what we call a hand loop, and get a good look, you know, look very carefully and get a good look at it. Thrips are often described as looking like little tiny alligators. They don't like to be out in the open. Most insects really don't. They're slender insects with fringed wings. Some species of thrips feed on other insects or mites. There are predaceous thrips, and if you look online, you can actually find insectuaries that sell predaceous thrips. And some feed on fungal spores and pollen. There are about 5,000 species of thrips. They have a distinctive cigar-shaped body, elongate with transversely constricted bodies. And they go through incomplete metamorphosis, which means the little ones look like the adults. The rate at which thrips move through their development cycle is highly dependent on environmental conditions, including the temperature and nutrient quality of the food source. Over 20 plant-infecting viruses are known to be transmitted by thrips, another good reason to control them. Now, you do want to suppress the population as much as possible. You're not going to eradicate them. Now, we have a new thrip that attacked Myoporum, and I'll show you this thrip next. That's our next picture. Let's take a look. Myoporum thrips. Now, Myoporum, bring that up full screen. You get a good look at it. Here are the thrips, and again, they're long and skinny. Now, notice how deformed this foliage is. You see this? This is a leaf. These leaves are all galled and really screwed up. This particular thrip on Myoporum causes severe galling of the tissue, and then it causes defoliation. Now, Myoporum is a shrub that is Australian, native to Australia, mostly grown along the coast and in the cool areas along the coast, so into West LA and places like that. I don't see it a lot in the hot inland valleys, although it will grow there as well. But this thrip is decimating Myoporum throughout Southern California, and probably now the whole state. I haven't checked recently to see how far or extensive the distribution is, but I don't believe anything would stop it from going wherever it wants to go other than freeze. So you might not find it at Big Bear, but you'll find it all along the coast. So Myoporum, I've been grown here in Southern California for many, many decades with no problems. Then suddenly this thrip showed up, and when it was first looked at by entomologists, no one had ever seen it before. It was a new species to science with no description. This is not unusual. This has happened repeatedly, especially in Australian plant material. It'll be growing here in California for many years with no problem. Suddenly we get an insect on it, and the insect population on that host explodes, and it devastates that particular species. And that's what's happening with Myoporum. So the plant, the bush will defoliate. There's a prostrate Myoporum species that grows really low as a ground cover. There's others that grow as shrubs. It's a genus, Myoporum, and it has a variety of species in it. But the thrip goes to all the species, and it causes the leaves to be twisted and curled and badly deformed. And then the plant defoliates, and if this goes on long enough, it kills the plant. So that's kind of unusual. Now, when they found the thrip, they sent it off to some experts on thrips from Australia. And the Australians had never seen it before. And that's interesting because we know for a fact that it has to be native to Australia. There was a publication where it was described and named. I don't recall the name now. It was moved from several different genera at first when it was found. So it's just interesting that in Australia, you can't find it because it's under biocontrol. There are things eating it that suppress it, either little tiny parasitoid wasps or something that prevents it from becoming an enormous problem. Here, we don't have that. We've got just the plant and just the pest and no control agents that will suppress it. I don't know if anyone's looking for them right now because Myoporum is not all that important a plant material. No one's making a living growing Myoporum. Now, there's another thrip that we get on Ficus microcarpa. Let's take a look at that one. This is the Ficus thrips. Bring that up. If you grow Ficus nitida or microcarpa. Some people call it microcarpa variety nitida. Some people call it Ficus nitida. But you can see the damage. A lot of thrips cause this kind of galling or severely deformed foliage. This is just more of a nuisance on these ficus. They can make them look a little unsightly, but it doesn't kill the plant. And sprays are often difficult. You have to use a systemic. So often people use either imidacloprid under the merit label, or they might use orthene as a spray, and that'll clean it up. But you have to pretty much use a systemic. And same on the Myoporum thrips, because the leaves are all twisted and contorted. And if you use a contact material, it won't get down there and kill them. So you have to use a broad spectrum. Now let's talk a little bit about sharpshooters. Sharpshooters are sucking insects, and we have a wide variety of native sharpshooters in California, and sharpshooters are very, very important insects. They transmit bacteria called Xyala fastidiosa. Now, Xyala fastidiosa is a pathogen in plants and causes what we call scorch diseases, and also the diseases go by a variety of names. In grape, it's called Pierce's disease of grape. In all the newer hosts that have been observed over the last 10 to 20 years, it's called scorch. So oleander leaf scorch, olive leaf scorch, liquid amber, purple leaf plum, crepe myrtle, all of those are getting infected by Xyala, and those are called scorch. Almond leaf scorch, on the eastern seaboard, they've got one, they've got peaches that are infected by it, and it's called a peach phony disease. But that's because these diseases were observed before they understood what was causing it. The disease got a common name before they realized it was Xyala. So this one we're looking at here is a native sharpshooter called the red-headed sharpshooter. Bring it up full screen and you can see the little red head. Here's the little red head, so it's the red-headed sharpshooter. This next one is the green sharpshooter. Let's take a look at that one. Bring it up so you can get a good look at it. They're kind of bullet-shaped. They don't like to be seen. If they're on a branch or a twig, they will move around to the other side as you walk up. And let's take a look at our next one, which is the blue-green sharpshooter. These are all native sharpshooters in California. They're actually kind of attractive little insects. And for many, many years, these native sharpshooters moved Xyala from plants that grow along streams and drainage ditches, riparian habitats, because these sharpshooters are predominantly riparian. They live along streams and anywhere there's water. And they will be feeding on there and perfectly happy as long as those plants are well watered. Sharpshooters feed on the xylem. They don't feed on the phloem. That's quite unique for a lot of insects. And because of that, they need a lot of the water, because there's very few nutrients in the water or the xylem sap. The phloem has sugars in it, very rich food source for insects, but the xylem, not so much. So they got to get a whole lot of it. The other thing is that xylem is under negative pressure. So they've got to be able to suck it out of there against the negative pressure that's in there. So they have big heads and big muscles, and they pump it out. When plants get dry, they abandon the plants because it's just too hard for them to get the water out of the plant that they need for their food. And so they will, as if a stream starts to get smaller and smaller during the summer months and the plants become drought-stressed and dry, they will leave there and they will go into adjacent plant material that's being irrigated, like a grape vineyard. And so now they've acquired the bacteria from grasses and other plants that grow along the streams because the xylella, it naturally occurs throughout North America. There are many different subspecies or strains that have different host ranges. But for years, these sharpshooters would only go one, two, or three rows into a vineyard during the summer months when the plants in the stream are drought stressed, and they would move the bacteria into those first few rows, and you would get what is called the edge effect, that just the grapevines along the vineyard would get infected, and now xylella fastidiosa and Pierce's disease of grape, that's a fatal disease of grape. There's no treatment. Once the bacteria is living inside the xylem, and that's where it lives, that's why it's called xylella, it will kill the plant. So oleanders are dying, there's no treatment. You know, if your liquid ambers are dying, there's no treatment for that. Same on olives, crepe myrtles, purple leaf plum, and I can't think of anything else right now that's a host, but there's probably more. So if someone tries to sell you a treatment, forget it, there is no treatment. The plant's going to die. You might as well, as soon as you see symptoms, you might as well cut it down. Now in 1990, we got a new sharpshooter introduced to Southern California called the glassy wing sharpshooter. At least that's when it was found. It obviously introduced a lot earlier than that. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is the glassy wing sharpshooter. Bring it up. It's about a third bigger than our natives. It has these two white patches on the side, and it's got this very distinct modeling pattern on the head. And it's very similar to the smoke tree sharpshooter, but the smoke tree sharpshooter, which is native, is much smaller, only about two-thirds of the size of this. And so take a look at the next picture. It'll also show the glassy wing sharpshooter. The glassy wing sharpshooter is not riparian. It thrives in irrigated landscapes. Bring it up full screen so you can get a good look at this sharpshooter. And this one's pinned in our collection. And so you can see that modeling on the head. And it's kind of bullet-shaped. And so when that sharpshooter was introduced into California sometime prior to 1990, discovered in 1990, it really had tremendously detrimental effects for agriculture and for home gardening. Because now this sharpshooter can acquire the xylella from infected plants and spread it in landscapes. That's why we're seeing it in so many landscape plants now. That's why we're seeing it in liquid amber, in plums, olives, and oleander, and crepe myrtle. Because in the past, our sharpshooters didn't feed on those plants. So there was no pressure, there was nothing introducing it into those plants. So that's become a real problem. Glass-wing sharpshooter has now really established throughout Southern California, has been for decades, and is continuing to spread up into the Central Valley. There's actually a interior state quarantine for glassy wing sharpshooter. All nursery stock that's moved out of Southern California up into the Central Valley is inspected. But we're just not going to stop a little tiny insect from being moved around the state with so many plants being shipped all over the place. And really, how do you stop someone who's moving from Southern California, maybe up to Fresno or maybe to San Francisco, getting their plants from their backyard, putting them in a truck and driving up, and they bring the sharpshooter with them? For commercial shipments, we can inspect and get a pretty good, we can reduce the risk of it being moved, but we're not going to eliminate it entirely. Now let's talk about beetles. Beetles are the largest group of insects, the coleoptera. And beetles are a major pest for plants, both, you know, beetles that eat foliage, beetles that go into trees that are wood borers, bark beetles, wood borers, there's all sorts of beetles. Now this first one we're seeing here is the striped cucumber beetle. And this is a big pest. Bring it up full screen. And it will skeletonize leaves. And it, of course, cucumber, but it doesn't feed on just cucumber. It feeds on all sorts of plant materials. And 40% of all described insect species are beetles, about 350,000 species. Actually, I've heard up to 1.5 million species of beetles. They can feed on plants or fungi. They can break down animal and plant debris. They can eat other invertebrates, which means they're predators. The Colorado potato beetle and the boll weevil are infamous pests on those crops, on potato, and the boll weevil on cotton. There are actually beetles that are beneficial. Ladybirds or ladybugs are also beetles. They eat aphids, scale, and thrips. Like all insects, beetles' bodies are divided into three sections: the head, the thorax, and the abdomen. Beetles are generally characterized by a particularly hard ectoskeleton and hard forewings. Let's take a look at our next beetle. The next one is the tin-lined June beetle. And this is actually a native beetle. It feeds on the roots of pine as a grub or a larva. And when it emerges, the adult beetle comes out, and it's really quite spectacular. I think it's a wonderful look to it. It's really fascinating. It never really gets bad. It doesn't really hurt. It's not a particularly serious pest, but it's an interesting beetle that we see. Let's take a look at our next beetle, which is the green fruit beetle. Bring that up full screen, because we're going to see these in the next month or two. Now, the top side has this dull green, but the bottom has this shiny turquoise look to it. And we often get calls about this when it starts flying in the environment in mid to late spring. And people think this is the Japanese beetle. It is not the Japanese beetle. There are no Japanese beetles in the Western United States, at least none that we know of. Japanese beetles are present on the eastern seaboard and all the way up to into Missouri and St. Louis, but there aren't any in California that we know of. It is not introduced here yet. Occasionally we find them flying out of airplanes, and occasionally they show up, but it hasn't made it here yet. Our next beetle is the spotted cucumber beetle. This is another beetle that will skeletonize leaves. And here's another one, our Altissia flea beetle. This is another one that skeletonizes leaves. You can see the damage. Bring it up full screen so I can show you the damage. You can see the damage here. It's rasping away and stripping the leaf and just leaving the vascular tissue. Our next one is the elm leaf beetle. Let's take a look at that. And here, let's take a look at the alder leaf beetle and the damage it does. Now you can see this is skeletonizing, you see, and this is the larval form of the beetle here. So beetles almost always go through full metamorphosis. I don't think any of them are. I think all beetles go through full metamorphosis. But the larval form, which may look like a caterpillar, is, you know, skeletonizing this leaf. And if you have a heavy infestation, it can be devastating. Now, this next one is a beetle, but it's called a weevil. Weevils are beetles. And this is the Diaprepes root weevil. Bring this up full screen, because this is a very important pest. And it comes in different color variants. This one is kind of yellow with these black stripes. It can be orange. This area can be orange or red. The snout kind of identifies it as being a weevil. And let's take a look. Now, what's so important about the Diaprepes root weevil? It's also known as the citrus root weevil, because the grubs or the larvae feed on the roots of citrus and many, many trees, not just citrus, but are devastating to citrus. And they feed in kind of a concentric or kind of a spiral pattern on the root and do a lot of damage. And if the grubs have been feeding on the root system for some period of time, maybe a year or two, on something like a lemon, you can walk up and just push on the tree and it'll just topple over. It is devastating to citrus. We had an interior state quarantine for this. It was discovered some years ago down in Long Beach and in some spots in Orange County and San Diego County. Now it's all over the place. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is the Diaprepes root weevil grub. Bring that up full screen. This is the stage that is in the soil, feeding on the roots. And then it pupates, and this next picture is the pupa, and this is kind of a crazy picture. Let's take a look at it. This is the pupal stage, and then it will come out of this pupal stage as the weevil we saw just a moment ago, and these are in the ground, and so what you'll find is little holes in the ground, and the adult beetles will then climb. This will be right underneath the tree where it's been feeding on the roots, and then the beetle itself will crawl up the trunk of the tree, and the adult beetles will start feeding on the leaves, and they'll scallop the edges of the leaves. Beetles, most beetles that you're going to encounter, other than the wood-boring beetles, are chewing insects. And that's why I emphasized that earlier. There are chewing insects and there are sucking insects. Beetles are chewing insects. And so they have mandibles that can chew and macerate the tissue they eat. So these Caribbean root weevils will walk up the trunk of the tree, get on the foliage, and start scalloping the edges of the leaves. So if you see your leaves are scalloped, then you know you've got a chewing insect, and you're going to have to use something that controls chewing insects. So there's a couple of things that people started doing, especially the citrus growers. If you had a lemon orchard, or if you had any citrus orchard, you want to protect your crop from this. So the beetles will lay their eggs on the leaves. The larva will come out of that egg and then fall off the leaf all the way to the ground and then burrow into the ground. And then they'll feed on the root system for about a year, and then they're going to pupate and come out and walk up the trunk. And that's kind of the life cycle in a nutshell. And so how do you interrupt that? There's a couple ways to do it. One is putting a thick layer. Well, they actually used this kind of plastic matting that was permeable to water but would prevent the grubs from emerging from the soil and getting through. And so you had to put that underneath the lemon trees. The problem with it was when workers came in to pick the lemons, it would damage that and rip it. And then the beetles could walk up through those holes and get to the trunk. So I think one way to avoid that damage is to put a thick layer of mulch on top of the plastic that prevents the adults from emerging from the soil and getting on the tree. So you want to break that life cycle somewhere. The other thing was using systemic insecticides like imidacloprid, and that was very spotty. It worked on some trees, it didn't work on others. It was mostly because of the soil. Soils are quite variable. You can have a heavy clay, you can have a loam, you can have a sandy loam. You know, if you have a heavy clay, often the imidacloprid didn't get down into the roots and you didn't get a good application. So it was very spotty using imidacloprid. But that would be the way you would kind of approach it. You would put down an imidacloprid treatment in the spring, and you'd want to get it in real good, and then you would cover that with a cloth, some type of fabric to prevent the adults from getting out. Very kind of expensive way to control it, but this particular Caribbean root weevil, or the citrus root weevil, is devastating to citrus. Now, when it was first found down in Long Beach, it was feeding on coral trees. It'll feed on palms as well, so it has a very broad host range, and this, you know, could very easily be devastating in a landscape. It could kill some very large trees, although it takes time. Now, there's another beetle. I don't have any pictures of it right now, but I want to go to a video clip. It's the red palm weevil. Now, the red palm weevil was found a few years ago down in Laguna Beach, and it feeds in the crowns of palm trees. So it's really devastating because it kills the meristem, or the growing point of the tree. And where it's been introduced in Spain and other parts of the world, it has decimated palms. So let's take a look at our next video. This is palm frond exploration for red palm weevil. And then we'll talk a little bit more about the red palm weevil after we take a look at this video clip.
The Center for Invasive Species Research at the University of California, Riverside. On May 25, 2011, a Canary Islands palm suspected of being infested with red palm weevil was treated in a private residence at Laguna Beach. An observation window approximately 6 to 7 feet wide was cut into the crown of the palm. Here you can see a skilled palmero cutting away the fronds. The fronds that were dropped to the ground showed feeding damage caused by red palm weevil. When we cut into the base of the fronds with a hatchet, we could see feeding tunnels made by the larvae of red palm weevil, and some of these larvae included cocoons. These cocoons were empty. The adult weevils had emerged prior to the cutting of these fronds. Feeding damage was extensive in these frond bases, as evidenced by cutting into the fronds with the hatchet. You can see extensive feeding damage, pupal cases, and pupation chambers that the larvae had made into the bases of these fronds. You can see more pupal cocoons and weevil frass being pulled out of those feeding tunnels. This type of damage can kill these palm fronds, but in this instance it wasn't severe enough to cause palm frond mortality. The age of these fronds was estimated to be approximately 3 to 4 years of age. All palm fronds after they were removed from the tree were destroyed by chipping and then taken to a certified landfill and then buried. This was a precaution to prevent the accidental movement of red palm weevil throughout Southern California. After the observation window had been cut, it was treated with a contact insecticide, and then the soil immediately below the palm was pressure treated with imidacloprid, and then the trunk was sprayed with dinotefuran, a rapid uptake neonicotinoid. These three treatments were to provide control of red palm weevil in the infested palm tree.
So the red palm weevil has a really interesting story. It was first discovered down in Laguna Beach, and it hasn't been found since anywhere else in California. But one Canary Island palm, which is Phoenix canariensis, comes from the Canary Islands, was killed by it. And then it was found on several others. And Mark Hoddle, who's an entomologist from UC Riverside, and several other researchers were down there looking for the weevils, figuring out how to trap them, how to look for them, how to detect them. They found them in some palms. They did that treatment that you saw. They did a soil application with imidacloprid. They used a contact spray in the canopy. They did a trunk spray. And then over time, they weren't able to find any more weevils. Either they got very lucky and got there very early after they were infested, or there was something going on that people didn't quite know exactly, but they can't find them anymore in Laguna Beach. So we got a little lucky on this particular one, but you know, take a look at your palms, especially the leaves. If you see big gaps in the pinnae that you saw in that video, when the palm fronds are first coming up out of the in the growing point, the meristem, they're all tightly packed. The larvae are going to be feeding in there and chewing on the leaves and eating it. When they grow up and expand, you're going to have big kind of wedge-shaped areas where all the fronds or the pinnae or the leaflets were eaten. And that's your first sign that you've got red palm weevil. The next thing is you're going to find these big woven pupal cases on the ground underneath the palm tree. And that indicates that adults, you know, the larvae have gone through pupation and emerged as adults and flown off. Here in California, at least what we've observed down in Laguna Beach, is they go almost exclusively to Phoenix canariensis. Now, they can go to any palm. They are native to Indonesia. They were introduced into Spain. They've decimated palms across Spain. Now, Mark Hoddle, who's a UC Riverside entomologist, works on biocontrol and invasive insect pests. So he went to Indonesia looking for them. And this next video clip I'm going to show you is of Mark in Indonesia. And he's going to show you some of the larvae. And this is an interesting clip. So let's go to our next clip. Collecting and eating red palm weevil larvae. Let's take a look at this clip.
We've eaten these larvae cooked with our colleagues here from Lonson, but now I think it's time to man up and try and eat one in the raw like some of these fellows do. So you can see we have a big grub here. It's not the preferred life stage. Large head capsule on them, which I won't be eating. You can see him biting me.
So because he knows he's going
to
die.
It's time for man to bite back.
He did it.
No, just kidding. Actually, they are very sweet.
Very sweet?
It's very sweet.
I'm surprised. The skin is chewy. But those, they are pretty sweet to eat.
Very sweet.
So I've taken all the guts out. This is the exoskeleton, now the cuticle. They're still ground up. A few splinters from the inside.
This is where it came from right now.
Okay.
But yeah, these are edible raw. They don't taste disgusting and they don't have a foul texture.
Adi, it's your turn.
No, I give it for you because
I'm just
I have many, many opportunity here. So.
Oh, okay.
Thank you, Adi. Adi's a gentleman. He's sharing because he can eat these anytime.
Yeah.
Here's the rest of Mark's dinner.
So we've had a pretty good capture out of this log. It's probably about a quarter of a kg, at least, of pure protein here. And this is a food source that the FAO is encouraging local indigenous farmers like these fellows to grow. It's a very economic way to produce high quality, high volumes of protein.
It is not a disgusting thing to eat at all. Not bad. Actually, just to prove it, I'll eat another one.
You eat more? They're sweet.
Oh.
I'm really surprised. They're quite sweet to eat. It's just that the cuticle's a bit chewy.
Yeah.
But you could take that out and just throw it away or crunch it up. Swallow it.
So, it's interesting that they are used as a food resource in Indonesia, where they're native. And there's actually a couple different species of red palm weevil. And that was one of the things that Mark was working on when he was in Indonesia. It's believed that they were probably introduced into Laguna Beach by someone who was used to eating them from Indonesia or from some part of the world where they eat them, because it's hard to imagine how they got there. We're kind of lucky. We dodged a bullet on this. You know, palms are very, very expensive landscape element throughout California. Large Canary Island palms, or large palms in general, are expensive. $20,000, $25,000 to plant a full-size one with a crane. And there's a lot of things that are problems on them, and this would be a devastating problem if it got out throughout the whole state. But Laguna Beach has kind of a unique environment. It's surrounded by chaparral. It's miles and miles from the next landscape. When you're driving down to Laguna Beach, you go on that highway and you're going through that whole chaparral area. So a lot of those adult beetles might have taken off flying and never made it to another palm tree, because the red palm weevil only feeds on palms. It can't feed on anything else. So it's looking for a palm tree and it takes off flying. And perhaps when they did their treatments of the trees they found infested in Laguna Beach, they actually eradicated it. So that's pretty unique situation. We have an invasive pest. When it was found, a lot of people in the landscape industry, especially people who grow palms, were pretty much in a full panic and thought that this was going to be devastating for palms. And here we are many years later, and they have not found any additional palms. Now, there's a couple things that were interesting about all the work they did on red palm weevil. One is there's a pheromone that the beetles give off that you can use as a congregating pheromone and attract beetles. But that alone didn't work very good, because Mark went and worked on it in a lot of places. And they put out the pheromone and they wouldn't get very many beetles. And then they realized that if they cut up a palm tree and took the chunks and stacked them up and then put out the pheromone with it, it was a powerful attractant, and that they would get these flying adult beetles, or weevils I should say, coming right to it. And they would fly, they would be attracted right to it. So they did that in Laguna Beach and they still didn't get any adults. So that's indicating that there probably aren't any adults still left in the Laguna Beach area, and if they aren't there, then they're really nowhere in California. But you should keep your eye open. They've been introduced to California. It is a little hard to believe that they eradicated them so quickly and so easily. Now, the next, and we talked about this last week a little bit, the gold-spotted oak borer. Let's take a look at this, and let's talk a little bit about wood-boring insects. This behind me is the gold-spotted oak borer. It is attacking oaks down in the Cleveland National Forest. It was introduced from Arizona, almost certainly on firewood. Do not move firewood around the state. It's a good way to move wood-borne insects. Now, you often hear about bark beetle in pine, and bark beetle in pine are quite different from wood borers. Bark beetle go into the pine, right underneath the bark, and the larva, you know, the adult burrows in, lays the eggs. The larvae start feeding on the vascular cambium, which is critical to the life of the tree. So bark beetles in pines are devastating to pines. Some wood borers are not that bad. Now this wood borer, the gold spotted oak borer, is devastating oaks. And if you want, now we haven't seen it much outside of the Cleveland National Forest. It has been found up in Idlewild. We take a look at our next picture. You can see the distinct, bring this up full screen because I want to show you the distinct D-shaped exit hole right here. You see that? Well, I missed it a little bit. Right between those two arrows, right there. Well, I keep missing it. There it is, right there. And here's another one right here. You see, it's like straight on one side and like this. That's unique for an exit hole from a wood borer. And you saw how tiny the wood borers are. But this next picture shows you what they do to oaks. And let's bring this up full screen too. These are oaks down in the Cleveland National Forest. All these oaks in here are dead from the gold-spotted oak borer. And now this is a tremendous fire hazard. That would actually be the best way to get rid of the oak borers. The gold-spotted oak borer would let it burn. Now let's talk just a little bit more about pine bark beetle. Pine bark beetles, we have many native species of pine bark beetle. They can be Ips, which is a genus. They can be Dendrocnus, which is another genus. Often they go to just two or three different types of pines, or maybe just one pine. But they always just attack drought-stressed pines. So how do you control or prevent pine bark beetle? It's by irrigating your pines. And you want to deep water them once a month. Many of the pines we grow, the Canary Island pine, the Aleppo pine, the Italian stone pine, are native pines, the Jeffrey pine, the Ponderosa pine. These are very drought tolerant pines. And they don't need to be watered frequently. You don't need shallow, frequent irrigations. That's horrible for them. You want long, deep irrigations once a month. You can do that just during the spring months and then let them go dry all summer. That's fine. But if you let them get drought stressed, they'll be attacked by bark beetles. And once you've got bark beetle in the tree, there is no treatment. And just recently, a homeowners association contacted me because they had a recommendation to treat all their pines, 200 or 300 pines, with imidacloprid. It would do nothing to control the pine bark beetles. So it's all prevention. You can spray the trunks of the trees with a broad spectrum insecticide to keep the adults off. And you can do that once a quarter or several times in the spring. And that's really all your only option. Now, the other things I was going to talk about were grasshoppers and some caterpillars. Those are also chewing insects, but you really need to see the damage and get the insect to really know. But we're running out of time today. Next week, we're going to talk about integrated pest management. We'll talk about that for both fungal diseases or diseases and for insects. But until then, I want to wish you all a happy gardening. I want to thank our crew for putting on the show today. And then we'll see you next week and we'll talk about integrated pest management. Until then, happy gardening.